Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. I invite you all to stand as you are able as we continue our worship with our first song. Gracious Heavenly Father, when you came to live among us, you brought with you your kingdom, ushering it into this world and revealing your glory to us on the cross, your power revealed also to us on the cross. And as we gather here this morning to worship, to celebrate that, to celebrate all of the blessings we have in you, God, you meet us wherever we are. Whatever space we're in, wherever our hearts are, you meet us, you transform us, you redeem us, and you love us. So we pray that as we gather this morning for worship, that we would sense and feel that, but also that you would be in return honored and glorified in our midst. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
How are we doing today? This is unusual. We have more people on my right than on my left. The balance has shifted.
On the right side.
My right. The right, the correct side, John said. That's the correct side.
I didn't say the correct side.
It's great to be here with you this morning. I don't know where else you'd rather be. I can't think of any place I'd rather be than in this space worshiping with you all. Wherever those people are on Facebook watching us, whoever they are, hello, Facebook people. Thanks for joining us. Just would ask you to fill out the tear-offs on the bulletins for our attendance this morning. And Ryan's going to collect those for us this morning. Since I don't see Dave. He wasn't looking, so it was easy to pick him. I don't have anything else to say other than welcome, and it's great to be here with you this morning, and just hoping that you're as excited as I am to be here. So, let's pray the prayer of the day. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let's pray together.
Father God, you gathered your people into your realm, and you promised us food from your tree of life. Nourish us with your word, and empowered by your spirit, we may love one another and the world you have made. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Yes.
Our first reading for the sixth Sunday of Easter comes from the 16th chapter of Acts, beginning with the 9th verse. During the night, Paul had a vision. There stood a man of Macedonia, pleading with him and saying, "Come over to Macedonia and help us." When he had seen the vision, we immediately tried to cross over to Macedonia, being convinced that God had called us to proclaim the good news to them. We set sail from Troas and took a straight course to Samothrace, the following day to Neapolis, and from there to Philippi, which is a leading city of the district of Macedonia and a Roman colony. We remained in this city for some days. On the Sabbath day, we went outside to the gate by the river, where we supposed there was a place of prayer, and we sat down and spoke to the women who had gathered there. A certain woman named Lydia, a worshiper of God, was listening to us. She was from the city of Tithaea. And a dealer in purple cloth. The Lord opened her heart to listen eagerly to what was said by Paul. When she and her household were baptized, she urged us, saying, "If you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come and stay at my home." And she prevailed upon us. Here ends the first reading.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm for this Sunday is Psalm 67. Mm-hmm. Jacob.
We're not going to do it.
Just kidding.
That's still the song we get.
If it was, yeah.
Can we get on here? Learn the song.
The second reading for this sixth Sunday of Easter is from the 21st chapter of Revelations, beginning with the 10th verse and continuing through chapter 22. And in the spirit, one of the angels carried me away to a great high mountain and showed me the holy city of Jerusalem coming down out of heaven from God. I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God the Almighty and the Lamb. And the city has no need of sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God is its light, and its lamp is the Lamb. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their glory into it. Its gates will never be shut by day, and there will be no night there. People will bring into it the glory and the honor of the nations, but nothing unclean will enter it, nor anyone who practices abomination or falsehood, but only those who are written in the Lamb's book of life. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb through the middle of the street of the city. On either side of the river is the tree of life with its 12 kinds of fruit, producing its fruit each month, and the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. Nothing accursed will be found there anymore. But the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it, and his servants will worship him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. And there will be no more night. They need no light of lamp or sun, for the Lord God will be their light, and they will reign forever and ever. Here ends the second reading.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 14th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
You can stand if you'd like. You don't have to, but you can. Jesus answered him, "Those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words, and the word that you hear is not mine, but it is from the Father who sent me. I have said these things to you while I am still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." Can you stop at 27? "You heard me say to you, I'm going away and I am coming to you. If you love me, you would rejoice that I'm going to the Father, because the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you this before it occurs, so that when it does occur, you may believe. I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming. He has no power over me." Stop there.
You're
already done. Where did I stop?
30.
Yeah, that was it. Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
That didn't make any sense at all. You may be seated. I will do my best. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So thinking about that gospel text and what Jesus was saying to his followers, this sort of toward the end of the time of his public ministry, or the time he's spending with his disciples, his apostles. After this, he's not going to be doing much teaching or many miracles. Really, the focus for him at this point in Jerusalem is what's going to happen at the end of the week as it's recorded there. And that's, of course, his betrayal and his arrest and his crucifixion and those things as well. He's basically said at this point, "I've taught you everything you need to know. Everything you will need to know has been given to you." And implied in that, and also referenced in other parts of the Gospels, are you're not going to really understand everything that I'm teaching you until it's over. Until not just when I've been crucified, but when I've been resurrected. And then finally when I ascend into heaven. But I'm going to send to you a helper. You're not going to be alone, but trust me when I say to you, you'll get this at some point. It may not make much sense right now, but it will. But the sort of theme that I'm sensing from that passage in Jesus speaking with his disciples, there's obviously a very deep sense of tenderness and pastoral care for the ones who were following him. Jesus, well, he was a pretty good pastor, I would say. Not bad at preaching and teaching, and those miracle things were always wonderful. Wouldn't it be cool if pastors could actually do that? Performing miracles. That'd be my superpower. But it's very much relational. I mean, obviously, that was one of the points, one of the purposes of Jesus in the incarnation was to help foster and further the relationship that we have with God. To know God in a human form, not as human, but to make God much more relatable to us. Because prior to that, there was this great sense of fear and trembling and being in the presence of God. It was thought in the Old Testament that nobody could see the face of God or they would die. There was a great fear of that. And when God spoke, either through voice or thunder or however it was that God spoke, the people fell on their faces in great fear. The relationship that God had with his people prior to Christ was a bit tenuous, to say the least. There was a great deal of, I'm not going to necessarily say misunderstanding or confusion, but the rules of engagement were a lot different prior to Jesus than they are for us today. It wasn't always that way. And part of me wonders if maybe it would have been better for this sermon to have the Genesis passage, something from Genesis bookending with Revelations and the Gospel in the middle. Because if you read the story in Genesis of creation, after God had created everything, the heavens and the earth, and finally created people, there is this deep sense of intimacy and fellowship and relationship between God and Adam and Eve. There was a presence between them. God fellowshiped with. He dwelled with Adam and Eve in the garden until, of course, they ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. That severed everything, at least in terms of that deep level of intimacy between them, because, of course, we know why. That's the original sin. Not the act of it itself, but the free will being exercised by human people with regard to all that God had promised them and all that God had provided for them in the garden, saying, you have everything you need. There's nothing you are going to lack or want for. It is all here. I've given you everything. What more could you possibly ask for? And the human said, well, we'd like to be like you, because that's what free will does. And that sense of independence, that ego in us that resists being obedient to or under the authority of anything or anyone else, reared its ugly head, and that created this deep chasm between God and human beings. But God never stopped pursuing the people, never stopped in his efforts to show them kindness and love, and made several covenants with them, saying, I'm going to in some ways recreate this garden environment. The stain of sin is still going to be there, but I'm going to provide for you. I'm going to be with you. I'm going to protect you. I'm going to guide you and lead you. I'm going to be the light in this crazy world that you all have created by your desire to want to be like me. If God were human at that point of the eating from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, God likely would have said, okay, that's it. I'm done with you. We're not going to keep doing this. But even more, as people disobeyed and disregarded and abandoned and worshipped other gods, certainly nobody among us would ever have the patience like God. Proving over and over and over and over and over and over again that this desire that God has to be in a relationship with human beings is unbreakable. It is immovable. Unstoppable. God will never, ever, ever quit on us. And though we can debate, and many people have, and argue, and wonder, and question, what about all the things that have happened since that time and until now, or even up until the point of Jesus, all of the craziness that's a part of the Old Testament. Those of us who have been gathering on Wednesdays to study, you know what I'm talking about. The questions that come up, well, why did God do that? And how come God didn't do this? And what was wrong with the people, and why? And I don't have answers to all of those questions because I'm not God, but in all of it, grace is being made known. God is extending his grace to people because he never gives up on us and continues to pursue that idea of a relationship with us. Part of the problem is, well, everything changed when Christ came to live among us, when the incarnation happened, and God became one of us. And as I said in my prayer, brought and ushered in the kingdom of heaven with him and changed the dynamic, not just through the incarnation, not just through his life and his teachings and the things that he did, but because of the cross, covering up the consequences of our sin. But not only that, taking the weight and the burden of our brokenness onto himself so that we can have that kind of relationship that he had with God. The level of intimacy, the level of fellowship that is unlike anything we have in this world. He made possible for us. That's the peace that Jesus was talking about. When he says, I'm not going to leave you alone. I'm not going to abandon you. I'm going to leave peace with you. I'm going to leave you my peace. Peace that he has with the Father. And I define this term every time I speak about it because it's easy for us to think of peace in terms of a lack of conflict or of everything being super great and perfect in our world. Like I'm not upset about anything or anxious about anything or worried about anything or fearful of anything. How many moments like that do you have in your life? Not too many. Doesn't happen very often. But that's not what he's talking about. That's not the peace that Jesus is referring to. It's the shalom peace. It's the Hebrew word shalom, of the unity between God and human beings. It is the relationship that has been fostered between God and human beings by Christ. It is the unity that Jesus has with the Father. And that's why he references that in that passage of him and the Father being as one, and it's not he who speaks, but the Father speaks, and he's revealing the Father. Over and over again, Jesus speaks of that relationship, because what was missing from Jesus that we have?
Sin.
Yeah, that's, thank you. That was an easy one, guys. That was I just logged that one up there. It was fat, just right in the middle. Mike Trout home run. Yeah, it was, I know it's hard to, nobody wants to answer his questions in church, because just say Jesus, that's, unless it's a question about Jesus. Of course, it's sin. And so it's way, way more theological and way beyond our understanding to try to figure out how God and Jesus are connected as one. But the thing that he doesn't have that prevents them from not having that kind of perfect unity, the perfect relationship, the perfect peace, is the fact that Jesus was sinless. And Jesus is saying, I'm going to give you that same thing. I'm going to give you that same relationship with the Father, but also with me, and leaving you the Holy Spirit to sort of produce all of this. Again, I can't explain all of that and how it works, but if Jesus is saying it, then it has to be true. He doesn't just make stuff up or say things because it sounds awesome, though he does say things that are awesome. He makes that relationship possible for us. And that's the way it's always been for those of us who live in this era of the New Testament, the era post-Jesus, that it's always been that way. I imagine that for the people living in Jesus' day and the ones who were still alive decades after his death, as Paul was writing and as the apostles were teaching and his word was spreading about what Jesus was doing and the struggles they had with not abandoning their religion, Judaism, or their pagan worship, but trying to figure out how this relationship can work, because nobody had that kind of a relationship with any God. It was always uncertain. It was always a bit reckless. It was always confusing. And it was never intimate. It was never close. It was never the way it was with Jesus and the Father. And so as they struggle with that, that's a lot of what those teachings about the sacrifice and about the temple in the Revelations passage, about we're not going to need a temple anymore because God's going to be the light and the temple and the thing that we, that place of worship is God. It must have been very, very confusing for them and a hard thing for them to change, because that's the way they had always done things. None of us like change, but especially well, that's always the way we've done it, so why would we change that? Well, we're not in that situation. It's always been that way for us. And so when I say to you that you have this possibility of having this almost perfect level of intimacy with God, you're going to look at me and, because I think myself, no, that's not possible. It can't be. How can that possibly be? Because I don't always feel that way. I don't always feel that deeply connected with God, because I just don't. Well, the truth is, it's not God's fault. It's not necessarily our fault either. The sin that's a part of us is not anything that we did on our own. We can blame Adam and Eve. When we get to heaven, we can all point fingers at them and go, "You ruined everything! What are you doing here? Screwed up all." But I think part of the problem is also that we look at our relationship with God or with Jesus in the same way as we define the terms of our relationships with everything else that we have in our world. Human beings, especially. The relationship we have with other humans, regardless of the nature of that relationship, is a give and take from both of us, from both sides. You can't have a friendship or a partnership or a marriage or even a parent and a child, or any kind of relationship without expecting something and giving something in that relationship. It's just impossible. you wouldn't have the kind of relationship where you were the only one that was doing things and giving while the other person just basically, that's not a friendship. That's called stalking. We don't, it's totally something different. In our relationships, we do those things. We do things for the other person in order to build a foundation of a relationship on things like trust, on things like respect, on things like, well, love. Those are the ways in which we show those things. If you say you're going to do something for somebody and you do it, you're building trust and you're building a relationship. What happens if you say you're going to do something and repeatedly over and over again do something completely different? There's not going to be a relationship. It is a two-way avenue or a street. And that's because we each need something from the other person in order to have that kind of relationship. We need something from them, whatever that might be. The problem or the difference between our relationship with other human beings versus our relationship with God is that God doesn't need anything from us. God's desire for us has nothing to do with God lacking anything. God doesn't need the love that we have to give him. God is self-actualized in the truest sense of the phrase. God is God apart from us. God didn't create because he had to. He didn't send his son because he had to. He didn't die on a cross because he had to, because he would be lonely without us, or because God's ego would be terribly bruised if we didn't recognize how awesome God is. God is fully aware of who God is, completely and totally. So God's pursuit of us is just because of the nature of who God is. And God gives and gives and gives and gave and continues to give apart from that need or desire for us to return favor. And so it's not a transactional relationship. It is a fully grace-based relationship from God's perspective to us. But we treat God as if God is sort of human. And we withhold things or we have expectations from God like, why didn't you do this? Or why aren't you doing this? Why is my life so chaotic? And why don't I feel this sense of perfect peace between myself and between you? Well, part of it's because of our brokenness, but part of it is because we don't necessarily invest in that part of our life or our world because God's not standing with us. If Jesus was here today, we'd all be gathered around and hanging out with Jesus, watching him cook fish for us, maybe making some bread, you know, breaking bread, pouring glasses of wine for everybody. What's up, JC? How you doing, man? Just great to see you. Like his disciples had with him, to spend all that time with him. So this distance between us, in a way, it's bridged by the Holy Spirit, but there are things that we can and should do that help to bridge that gap and bring that close that gap of distance. And it's done by the Spirit, and I can't explain it, and I don't know that I can articulate it that well, but how do you feel when you're sitting in the pews? How do you feel when you come to worship? How do you feel when you leave? Or actually, when you're on your way in, is there a different sense of you when you walk through those doors? Like you've come home, like you're in a place that's different than what exists out in the world. How do you feel when you're praying? How do you feel when you're spending time speaking to God? Not asking God for all the stuff that you want, but speaking to and having that fellowship and intimacy with God. And yes, God sometimes does speak back to us. If you're hearing voices, maybe you want to check with a psychologist, but it's not a voice, it's a sense or a feeling. But how do you feel in that midst? Problems of the world sometimes seem to kind of back up or back away from us. The pressure of the world in our life isn't quite the same as it is when we're out doing the things that, frankly, we have to do because this is the world that we live in. God ushered in his kingdom into our world through Christ, but did not kick out the earthly kingdom. And so, as I always say, we're mixing and living in those spaces. When you're reading Scripture, is there not a sense of something greater? Is there not a sense of connection in that? Because those words have power. When we're serving others, when we're following in Jesus' footsteps, is there not something that feels different about that? It's really hard to be angry at people when you're praying for them. It's really easy to be angry with people when they've done terrible, hurtful things to you. Don't often have bad thoughts when you're in worship. At least I hope not. And I feel like it's because that's where we close that gap and we're in the presence of God. And we're feeling and sensing that perfect peace, that intimacy, that fellowship that we have, not just with one another, but with God. And when we step out of that to go do things that we have to do in this life, God doesn't step away from us, but is there, always. It's just a matter of how often we think about, how frequently we invest in the things of the kingdom, doing the things that Jesus did, following in his footsteps, listening to his commands and his instructions so that we can experience that perfect peace. It doesn't happen necessarily on its own. There are times when it does. It doesn't, but it's not because God ever pulls back from us or needs anything from us in order to give stuff to us. That one's written in stone. That's never going to ever change. But how much we want or crave or desire or need that sense of peace in our lives is largely determined by the things that we do and how we live our lives. And one of the devil's tricks is to keep us busy. I don't have time for that. I just don't have time. Even you retired people, you're busier than people who have jobs. And you have the freedom and the time to spend to say no to this or no to that, so I could spend some of my time in the presence of God. But even us working folks, driving to work, turn on a Christian radio station and listen to praise music. It's much more difficult to be angry at people on the road when you're praising Jesus. Have devotions on a regular basis. Join a Bible study. Come to worship and experience that joy and that peace that can only be experienced in the midst of those spaces that I just mentioned and others. Even just sitting someplace that is peaceful and serene and recognizing that God is the source of that, the beauty of creation, is that in that same sense a place of worship. Just being aware of it. Not defining our relationship with God in the way that we define our relationships with other humans. It's different. It's unique. It is unlike anything this world has to offer to us. Jesus promises us that, and it's made possible because of his Holy Spirit. Praise be to God that he has given us that gift. And in this crazy, crazy life, this side of heaven, we have that place of escape. We have that place where we can go and rest in the Father's arms. We can hang out with Jesus, speak with him, and feel his presence, and know beyond a shadow of a doubt that we are loved. Amen. Please stand as you are able for our next song.
Well, let's praise and bless his name when things are going well, things are not going well. God is God and Christ loves us no matter what, whatever's happening. Blessed be your name. One, two, three.
Gracious and loving God, we offer our praise to you. We praise you, God, for your perfection. We praise you, God, for your wisdom and your power and your might, for your greatness and awesomeness beyond anything we could possibly understand, in the ways in which you reveal to us your glory. Especially thankful for the cross and the sacrifice that you made for us, for your pursuit of us, for your desire to want us to know you as well and as perfectly as we can, for the peace and hope and joy you offer us through your endless and limitless love and grace. God, in your mercy, we lift up our prayers of intercession for this world and the people in it, for the brokenness that is a part of this world that manifests itself in so many ways, in nature, in creation, in our broken relationships, in sickness, in mental illness, in addiction, in poverty, in so many other ways, loneliness, isolation, fear, anxiety. God, we are surrounded by all of those things. And we know you know what we need, whatever it might be, and for those that we care about, you know what their needs are. And so we lift up to you this world and the people in it, praying for healing, hope, and that perfect peace for all who have need. Those on our prayer list and those we name to you silently now. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Thank you, Lord, for inspiring us. Thank you for your church. Thank you for gathering us here and all throughout the world in fellowship with you and the Father and the Holy Spirit and with each other through the power of the Spirit, God. We are one in this world. We are called here at Grace-Covina to be the light of your world in this part of the earth. Continue to inspire us and other fellowships, other groups, other churches like ours that live to glorify and to praise your holy name. I pray especially, God, for the new bishop elected in the Pacifica Synod, Pastor Dave Nagler, and for the other bishops of the ELCA and for fellow pastors and lay leaders. That you would guide all of us, God, to lead your people into the truth of who they are and how we are to live our lives. God, in your mercy. And for those unspoken prayers and things that we don't like to even think about, God, you welcome them all and invite us to bring them to you for healing, for whatever it is that we need. And so we offer those things to you as well, trusting in your mercy through your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Please turn and share God's peace. Stand as you are able as we pray over our offering. Let us pray.
Blessed are you, O God, creator of all things. Through your goodness you have blessed us with these gifts, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Use us in what we have gathered in feeding the world with your love. Through the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
In the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he gathered with his disciples. He took a loaf of bread, he broke it, and he gave thanks. And he gave it to them to eat, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the meal had ended, Jesus took a cup of wine. He gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this also in remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let's pray the prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. You may be seated. Thank you. Please stand as you are able to receive the blessing. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. We're in gymnastics. Announcements. Don't have really much by the way of announcements, I guess. I will be over in the fellowship hall prepping for this week's painting. It's been a while. We had Easter and we had Mother's Day and we had people missing and other things going on, like the post office stamp out hunger collection that took place last weekend. So we'll get back at it today. If you want to come and help tape or reel the paint roller or whatever, or just jeer at us or criticize us for not doing a good job, that's fine too. We can take it.
You missed a spot.
Yeah, exactly. What are you gonna do with that spot? Other than that, middle of the month. I'm still, if anybody has any ideas for what we could do for a fellowship event, then, you know, come to me. Otherwise, it's going to be another Pastor Steve wins a chili cook-off. Which I'm okay with.
But.
Cheryl has, yes, Cheryl.
I just want the congregation to know that last Saturday we had the post office food drive. We got 11.5 tons
ooh,
of food.
Ooh,
wow. They loaded it from the post office trucks onto our truck, and station wagons and pickup trucks, brought it here, unloaded it, and by Wednesday we had it all put away. So thank you to those that did help, and it is a real blessing to our clients.
Yep, absolutely. Amazing stuff going on there. So other than that, I don't think I have any other announcements. Jeff has one. Oh,
yes. If you would like
AV training,
learn how to run the overhead and the music and how to set up stuff in case Jeff's sick on vacation, mental health day, whatever. Because sometimes I would like to be fishing on something. But I'm just saying. Please stay after the service today. Have your donut, have your fellowship, but then come back here. Just let you know there will be a test, and Keith has already cheated. So
I get to look at your paper.
So clearly cheating is acceptable.
Jesus is so acceptable at this. So yeah, we can always use volunteers to help out and learn. And if you're just interested in how this works, please stick around, and we'll get through this. I think we'll all learn something today.
To cheat.
Do you want to know how he cheated? He showed up really early and showed initiative. So.
You can.
All right. Please stand as you're able as we sing our final song, Good, Good Father.
Thank you.
like you. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and in all things fill you with his peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Our worship here is ended. Go in peace and serve the risen Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Go have a donut. Go get a donut.
You're a good